But the actual appearance of HMS Sovereign of the Seas is still very much open for debate, mainly because most of the information on it was destroyed by fire when the Dutch invaded Chatham Dockyard in 1667. Therefore, there are few surviving records of her build or her many refits. Those that do survive give us an insight into a ship that employed some groundbreaking techniques in its structure, had a career spanning 60 years, and inspired one Dutch admiral to nickname her the Golden Devil. Before I get into the design proper, I would like to recap on part one of this presentation. There are several main sources of information about the ship and how she looked as she was built. The painting of Peter Pett and with the stern of Sovereign of the Seas by Peter Lely. The engraving by John Payne of Sovereign under Full Sail. The drawings of William van der Velde the Elder, or all of the above, are accredited to being done during or shortly after her commissioning. Also, the technical drawings in the National Maritime Museum, which show profile and body plans of the ship as Royal Sovereign. These must have been drawn after the restoration of the monarchy in 1660, and unfortunately for us, are thought to have been drawn as late as 1795. The reconstruction done by Sir Robert Steffings, a naval architect in the 1800s, and his resulting model. The National Archives at Kew, which housed the state papers of Charles I, and Woolwich Dockyard Museum, which has tantalising glimpses into bits of her repairs and rebuilds. The book Sovereign of the Seas by James Sefton, who devoted 40 years of his life to studying the ship, and more recently, the theoretical reconstruction conducted by John Mackay and a team of naval architects and graphics artists, published in 2020 by Seaforth Publishing. However, a great deal of the design in this book is based on Dean's doctrine of naval architecture, which was not written until 1670. Mackay has assumed that things had not changed in those 33 years, when in fact they had advanced quite a bit. All the above sources show differences in her design, dimensions, and construction. So which do we believe? The information that I will use is that which I know to be from the original sources and can be verified by viewing the appropriate documents. It will not cover the multiple refits and rebuilds that took place during her lengthy career, unless they are relevant to her initial construction. However, some of the illustrations and schematics I'm using are from various sources and may not be from original sources. These are used for illustration purposes only and to clarify methods of construction. When Charles I originally appointed Phineas Pett as the shipwright for the design and building of Sovereign of the Seas, he gave Phineas a basic specification for the ship. This was the length of the keel, approximately 127 feet, the breadth moulded of approximately 45 feet, depth in hold of approximately 19 foot 6 inches, draft of water approximately 19 foot 6 inches, an approximate tonnage of 1,450 and an armament of 90 cannon. The tonnage proposed was obtained from the three main dimensions as was normal at the time. That is the length of the keel times the breadth moulded times the depth in hold divided by 75, which gives us 1,522. The actual tonnage would not be calculated until after the ship was built. Following the initial specification, Charles handed the finalisation of the design over to a committee of four master shipwrights, together with Phineas and Peter Pett. After 7 months of discussions and arguments, the final specification was agreed as shown on the slide, and presented to the king, who approved it and instructed the father and son team to produce a final design for his approval. This they did using the usual practice at the time in the form of a model and a set of lines drawings. Unfortunately, none of these have survived. This is an etching of Charles I with the model of Sovereign of the Seas. It was taken from sketches made at the time and discovered in the then Public Records Office, but the etching was not published until 1919. The depiction of the ship varies from Phineas Pett's description in that the model was supplied with an open construction and was only planked from the lower gun deck upwards. This model shown with Charles was either incorrectly drawn or may not have been Sovereign, although this seems unlikely as the model is in the etching is a three-decker. This is a starboard side profile, or as it was in those days, the larboard side profile, and a representation of what is it is thought the Sovereign of the Seas model would have looked like. However, this drawing shows the gilding decoration, which would not have been on the original model. When the final specification and model were presented to the king, he made numerous changes to the aesthetic appearance of the ship, including adding a massive number of decorations, all of which were to be gilded. He also insisted on increasing the armament to 102 cannon. This gave the shipwrights a problem in that as a 90-gun ship, the length of the lower gun deck, as designed and approved, would not accommodate any more cannon. The answer to this was to increase the breadth to 46 foot 6 inches and add a further deck to make three gun decks. This increased the draft of the ship to 22 feet 6 inches due to the increased weight. A further complication of this increase was that the lower gun port sills were now only 3 feet 6 inches above the load waterline. This would later prove to be a significant problem when fighting the ship in any sort of inclement weather. Most of the documents I have viewed deal with the construction of the frames and planking. There seems to be little surviving that gives us any idea of the deck layout or her standing and running rigging. There are some notes in Woolwich Dockyard Museum concerning her anchors, free source for the masts, the rope source for the rigging, and the stores taken on, but nothing about the deck layout or mast construction. The timber for the ship was obtained from all over England. The Royal Forests at Chapwell Woods and Bransmith Park, both between Newcastle and Durham, supplied the oak. It is known that 2,500 oaks were felled from these parks, and as a royal warrant was required to fell trees, these are listed in Charles's state papers. It is not definitely known how many trees were felled altogether, but it has been estimated at around 11,000. They were stripped of bark whilst growing in the spring and not felled until the second autumn after that. This was known as girdling and was a means of producing a harder timber before felling, meaning a shorter period was required for seasoning. It was noted in some documents about what one of the refits that after 47 years, all the old timber in her was so hard that a nail could not be driven into it. The keel was laid on the 21st of December 1635 at Woolwich Royal Dockyard in the southeast of London. The ship should have been built at Dartford Royal Dockyard, but with its increased size, the depth of water at Woolwich was greater and the river wider, which would make for a better launch. It had a length of 127 feet and was 2 feet square and was made from straight lengths of sawn elm scarfed together. This was unusual for the time and was a first for the Petts. Solid elm from whole trees were the usual method. These were joined with doublers and iron bolts. This slide shows the frame layout of HMS Dartmouth, but this is the closest I could find to how Sovereign was constructed. The main difference, of course, is size. Dartmouth was a 28-gun frigate and a lot smaller. This diagram has been slightly exploded, and the frames of Sovereign had 6 futtocks and an extra long top piece and were butted up to each other. The frames along the keel were of seasoned English red oak, 2 feet 6 inches square, spaced 2 feet 6 inches apart. The pets made chunky ships, really. Each alternate futtock was butt jointed to its predecessor. The futtocks were attached in a doubled arrangement, with the even numbered ones fixed to the odd numbered ones by copper bolts and trenails. This continued up to the 6th futtock, where an extension piece was attached, and this was tapered above the main deck down to 9 inches wide by 4 inches thick at the rails. The frames were spaced on the keel by deadwoods, 2 foot 6 inches square by 2 feet long, fixed to the keel with iron spikes. There is no mention in the surviving documents of having filler frames fitted, although this would not be required as the doubled frames should lay alongside each other. On top of the frames, the keelson was constructed the same as the keel, but 2 feet wide and 18 inches deep, and made from seasoned English oak. It was bolted to the keel by iron bolts, clamping the frames to the keel. Her outer planking was elm, ranging from 9 inches thick by 14 inches wide at the garboard strake to 3 inches thick and 12 inches wide at the main deck rails. This is a photo of my uncompleted model showing the mainmast chains and the hull coating. The hull was double planked except for the garboard strake and had a coating of what was called paying stuff, which was a mixture of pitch, tar, tallow, resin, sulphur and horsehair sandwiched between them. The outer hull below the waterline was also given a coating of paying stuff as well, and this was followed by a coating of white lead and resin. This had proven useful at keeping the Teredo sea worms at bay. The planks behind the carved decoration were treated with Stockholm tar, and this black was the only other colour Charles allowed on the hull of the ship besides the gold. And another one of my models showing the black coating behind the decorations. And those decorations are not completely finished yet. The main whales, which were installed in pairs, except for the topmost whale, which was a single, were 12 inches thick by 14 inches wide, again of elm, and were installed in short lengths, scarfed together, to take account of the curvature of the hull. All plank strakes and whales were fixed to the frame using trenails. These ranged from 1 to 3 inches in diameter, depending on the size of the timber being fixed. They were made of oak that was baked in an oven to dry before being used. This ensured they expanded to a tight fit as they absorbed moisture from the air. There were 2 trenails on each plank to frame joint, and 4 on each whale to frame. Although it is almost certain, it is not stated anywhere that she was fitted with a false keel. But if she were, this would have been in the form of a strip of oak applied to the bottom of the keel with iron staples, and would be 3 or 4 inches thick and the same width as the keel. There are no details of the inner planking, but going on the dimensions on other ships of the time, these would be approximately 9 inches wide by approximately 3 inches thick. Again, trenails would have attached them. From here on in, the details of her construction are very sparse. Only small notes of parts of her still survive. Most of these are lodged in the National Archives at Kew and are mostly responses to questions asked by King Charles I. What we do know is the height between gun decks. These are measured from the upper side of one deck to the upper side of the adjacent higher deck. No allowance is made for the thickness of the deck timbers or the floor planks. This is not, therefore, an indication of the headroom between the decks, some of which was very low. The lower gun deck to the middle gun deck was 8 foot 10 inches at the forward end and 8 foot 6 inches at the stern. The middle gun deck to the upper gun deck was 7 foot 3 inches forward and 8 foot 6 inches at the stern. The upper gun deck to the forecastle was 7 foot 5 inches. The upper gun deck to the half deck was 9 foot forward and 9 foot 3 at the stern. And the half deck to the quarter deck was 6 foot 10 inches. The quarter deck to the poop was 5 foot 6 inches. You can see where the captain's cabin was housed between the upper gun deck and the half deck because it's the highest deck in the ship. This is the waist, showing the waist on my model, and the deck space between the after end of the forecastle and the forward end of the half deck was called the waist and was covered by a light spar deck, not shown here. Long lengths of fir called raft trees were supported by stanchions and turned pillars. Across the top was a light grating of deal boards, providing a walkway for the crew without the need for constant ascending and descending of stairs. This light spar deck is mentioned in Charles I's state papers and in Phineas Pett's autobiography, although it is not mentioned or shown on any of the plans of the many reconstructions conducted over the years. There is a huge amount of detail available about the cannon, although most of this concerns the stores taken on to supply the gunners for 6 months. I gave a list of the armaments in part one, so I will not do so again here, except to say that the gun ports were sized depending on which deck they were on. The lower gun deck had gun ports 2 foot 8 inches square, the middle gun deck 2 foot 6 inches square, and the upper gun deck 2 foot 4 inches square. The gun ports above the upper deck were all circular, 2 feet in diameter. Almost no detail has survived describing the actual deck layout and fittings, but this drawing is a reconstruction by John McKay, which for general illustrative purposes is a reasonable layout. We know there was a capstan that started on the lower gun deck, extending up through the each deck and terminated in the waist. We also know that there were 2 ornate companionways from the forecastle down into the waist and from the half deck into the waist, which made firing 4 of the cannon exceedingly difficult. You can see them, the step walkways there and one this side, and underneath each was a 16 pounder, which made them very hard to fire. If you look at the many kits about, they all have a different arrangement on deck, including the one that I'm currently working on, which is a bit of a labour of love that has been in progress for 10 plus years and is far from complete. In the kit, there are no capstan in the waist and which was used to stow the ship's launch. Another thing missing is the access companionways between the various decks. One item that is well documented is the decorations applied to her stern. Thomas Heywood designed these and they were carved by John and Matthias Christmas. The stern was documented both in the painting of Sovereign of the Seas and Peter Pett shown earlier and is sketched and described in the state papers of Charles I. This is shown here from the John McKay book. figurehead was of a depiction of the Saxon king, King Edward the Peaceful, who is shown defeating his enemies and trampling them underfoot. This is meant to be a representation of Edgar dominating all the countries in Europe. It was again designed by Thomas Heywood and carved by the Christmas brothers. It was totally covered by gilding, which added a quarter of a ton to the forward weight on the ship. I have included here a masthead rigging plan from John Mackay's book. There is no surviving record of her mast construction and rigging arrangement, but this is a reasonable representation of her rig. Sail handling remained mostly unchanged for several decades, and even when improvements came, they were usually done by individual captains and were not adopted widely throughout the fleet. It was not until the introduction by the Navy Board of a structured set of sailing instructions that things began to become standardised. What is known from the comments of several of her captains throughout her career is that she was difficult to manage and was slow in manoeuvring. This made her vulnerable and had to tie up several escorts to protect her. This is a very brief explanation of her known construction, although items of evidence are still being unearthed as more of the museums and the National Archives collections are digitized for access online. There are many things still to discover. This brings my brief presentation to a close.